India is struggling with the COVID-19 pandemic. Yet the country wants to engage with the global scientific community. So what is the alternative? The alternative is to do it virtually. And for that, there is a mega summit or a Kumbh Mela of global scientists which is happening and led by India, called Vaibhav. And I have with me today Dr. Lata Chakravarti. She is a specialist on management, more so on finance, but somebody who has some experience in managing technology and looking at startups. Dr. Lata works at the Indian Institute of Management, Shillong in Meghalaya. And let me start by giving my homage. That is such a important destination for all people who do any science and technology, because it was at the Indian Institute of Management, Shillong, where India's, I can say very surely, foremost management guru, APJ Abdul Kalam, the People's President of India, passed away while still speaking to an audience. Dr. Lata, welcome to the program. And what is Vaibhav and how is it helping India?
Right. I think this is a great initiative of our Prime Minister. India has always talked about the brain drain. It's been a few decades, since the brain drain started. And the best of our scientists, the best of our youth have moved west. And they're all doing well there. And it's a huge scientific community out there. There's a huge pool of management professionals, academicians in management institutions, and you name it, whichever profession, there are Indians there. And I think the time has come for this great initiative to bring together the scientists and the academicians in India to collaborate with the talent out there in the West, to contribute to the growth story of India, to contribute to increasing or improving the research output of our research organizations, as well as the academic institutions in India. And with this objective, this Vaibhav was launched by our Prime Minister on the 2nd of October on Gandhi Jayanti Day. And it had threefold objectives. One was to foster academic collaborations. Second is to find mechanisms to increase the research output of our R&D organizations. And the third is to find solutions using the management techniques for the kind of problems that we have in India and for making India Atmanirbhar. Certainly. So that was the focus.
Certainly. You mentioned about brain drain. Today, the mega corporations of the world are in a way led by Indians or people who have had training in India. You name it, Satya Nadella, you name all the big ones, really. Mr. Pichai, so many of them. And they've done so well. This Vaishvik Bharatiya Vaigyanik, and I can say a Mahotsav, how will this foster growth in India, and especially growth for research and development?
Yes. See, the success stories there in the West, they're the same Indians who have gone there, but they're successful there. And what they have taken with them or carried with them and what remains with them is the core values, with which they were brought up. And while the ecosystem there you know, promotes meritocracy, promotes, you know, talent. And there are disciplined people, and what we lack here is that discipline. And we are brilliant, and due to lack of that ecosystem and the discipline, we are unable to perform here. And therefore, this is a great initiative to bring together the Indians based outside India, what we call as the Indian diaspora, who are very eager to contribute. And I should say COVID has been very helpful, you know, in forging more of these alliances among the scientists in the West, the Indian scientists in the West and those who are here. Because the same, you talked about Kumbh Mela, you know, these kinds of annual conferences do keep happening often in India. But imagine the kind of huge cost that is incurred, you know, to bring them down here just for a few hours or a few minutes of interaction with them. And the same thing we could achieve during these times because of the constraints of COVID, we could achieve all this absolutely seamlessly without any obstacles or hitches. And I think there's been a mindset change that COVID has caused, that what we thought could not be achieved without bringing people face to face. And you know, the emotional connect is still there and will always be there. And whether you're interacting online or whether you're interacting face to face, that's still established. And that's what we could see during, you know, the series of panel discussions that we had over the last 3 weeks. And the personalities you named, the CEOs of the top US corporations, they have come out of not only the Indian educational system, they've gone to the West, and you know, they have also gone through the rigorous postgraduate and research programs, where again it is a whole lot of Indians who are the professors and the best of the universities. And I think it all the way, their success story can be attributed to the Indian education system, the Indian faculty in the West, and the Indian core values that is with them.
So do you think these 3,000 scientists who are gathering as part of Vaibhav, more than 50 countries being represented, will this really help the Indian startup ecosystem? And as somebody who's in the management domain and not a science and techie yourself, do you think we have a good startup ecosystem and an ecosystem which can sustain and nurture talent?
Yes. The statistics show that ours is the third largest startup ecosystem in the world. So already, you know, we are quite ahead, but we can always do with learning some lessons from success stories outside of India. And that is where, you know, the deliberations like Vaibhav will help us, because what there is something that's good here in our ecosystem, and there is something else that is there out there. And when they bring from their own experience, the faculty members who and the deans and directors who participated in the deliberations, when they bring their own experience from the West, the success stories of how the startups are nurtured there, and what is it that is lacking here, I think that is where you know, we are able to sense the challenges here, the opportunities that are there, and what is it that together we can do, you know, to bridge the gaps. See, in India, In fact, if I were to go into a little bit into the background of our session on entrepreneurship and growth, we looked at it from three perspectives. We called it three pillars. One was this technology-led entrepreneurship, which is what we call as the startups. There's a revolution happening there because there is so much that has become digital today. In every aspect of our life, there is this technology that is there, without which our life is kind of going to be in a standstill. So that is where there is a lot more support that is there. That there's a lot more funding also that is happening. You have a lot of interest among the foreign institutional investors, the angel investors, the venture capitalists. So the startup ecosystem has a lot of mentors as well among the the technology entrepreneurs who are leaders in various IT companies in India. So I think, to a large extent, the startup ecosystem is growing and is going in the right direction. And there's a lot that is likely to happen. The interest is already there. Even during the COVID times, the investments have significantly gone up. But at the bottom of the pyramid, we have the informal economy, which is full of entrepreneurs and who are there because of no choice. They did not go through any training, any formal training. They do not have any formal financing options. And they are there self-grown, as self-grown entrepreneurs. And we are doing a lot today. We are the government particularly is thinking of moving the informal sector to the formal economy. But the motivation is more because this is a huge part of the economy. And number one, we are unable to clearly estimate, measure the GDP of the economy because so much is happening in the informal economy. And therefore, we want to know what really is, is the GDP, the real GDP. That is one driving force. The other is this digital drive. This is an economy where, if it is all digitalized, you bring them into the formal economy, there is this potential to increase the tax revenues.
I knew you were getting there. That is, you can tax them. They are not taxed. Just yes. All management gurus yes. Want people taxed.
Yes. Yes. So these are the kind of, I would say negative motivations driving the government to, bring the formal the informal sector into the formal sector. But the entrepreneurial spirit has to be preserved in the process. That is the most important thing. They are not only entrepreneurs who are managing themselves, they also manage, they also employ. So there is also employment in the sector. And but for this large number of entrepreneurs at the bottom of the pyramid, there would be a huge pressure on the part of the government to provide jobs, to provide employment to them. They're all self-employed and they're all doing a lot of work, adding value. So what is important is to focus on this sector to see that you provide them with the minimum infrastructure, provide them with funding, and keep the entrepreneurial spirit alive while doing so. Not tax them, just because you have brought them into the, into the net. I think that is very, very important. The third the third pillar of our deliberations was on the family businesses. In India, 91% of the listed companies are family owned, family led businesses. And therefore, the success stories is in the family business in India. And for centuries, like Tatas and Birlas, they knew how to run businesses with a very strong value system. And just imagine the kind of charitable institutions that they have created across the country. So business is not just to make profits, but to distribute the profits for the welfare of the people. And I think that is one strong core value of family businesses, and which is what has helped them to sustain any of the big family businesses. If you see, they have a number of these charitable, long before we started talking about the CSR, you know, they were engaged in those activities, not by force, by some law, but that was their sense of giving back to the society. And what success, what can we learn from the successes of family businesses? How do we impart these success factors to the SMEs, the small and medium enterprises, to the small entrepreneurs? That was another thing that we discussed in the
A pleasure talking to you, Dr. Lata. And if I can summarize this in a small phrase, I think if Vaibhav can help in, like you started off by saying, from brain drain to brain gain, I think the purpose of having this Vaishvik Mahakumbh of minds, especially on science and technology, would go a long way. And COVID-19 offered an opportunity to do this virtually and to do it at relatively low cost. But I must add, I don't think there is any solution to not having face-to-face meetings. Both of us are meeting virtually, but ultimately it's really face-to-face meetings which help push the best in people. And like you said, from the bottom of the pyramid to the top, from family-run businesses to industrial houses, from leaders in the West holding Indian values, all of them would probably benefit through this summit, which is called Vaibhav, a literal Mahakumbh of minds from across the world, but focused on finding a good growth story for India in what is called the Atmanirbhar Bharat story as it unfolds. A pleasure speaking to you, Dr. Lata. In these COVID times, please take care of yourself, be safe. And you live in a lovely part of the country at Shillong. And I again pay my homage, because that was where our biggest techie management guru, APJ Abdul Kalam, the people's president, lost his life. Or I should say, he lives in our minds forever. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure talking to you.
My pleasure, ma'am.